They were at the University of Padua, where this group of people, of Venetian oligarchical families, particularly Gasparo Contarini and Pietro Bembo and others, which we write about, they got together and decided on an approach toward Reformation. They were Catholic prelates. All of them. And they decided on certain basic doctrine, which was the project democracy of its day, where they said the problem was that you cannot insist on the knowability of truth. That any doctrine that says that man, and particularly individuals of goodwill and good faith, could know truth was a blasphemous doctrine, that all we could have was faith. That's all humans were allowed, faith. Right? Now, but this was in a nominally Catholic monastery outside in Venice. Now they worked with others who were attempting to break into 1,000 pieces to unleash democracy in religion upon the world. In other words, yes, clearly the Catholic Church needed massive reformation at that point, right? There's no question about it. Many Catholics of good faith had decided that was necessary, right? But what had happened was that if you're going to reform something, you have to take it from a higher standpoint rather than have a million opinions proliferate. Unless you had a higher science, as Nicholas of Cusa, as you will hear tonight, you know, had, and attempted to reform the Catholic Church from a higher standpoint on the basis of Concordantia Catholica, the attempt to reform it on a lower standpoint, on an Aristotelian standpoint, which took man away from intelligible knowledge of the universe, based upon hatred of the physical universe, would allow you no science, would allow you no relative potential population density, right? And by unleashing what was essentially a project democracy in which you get 100, not just in the Protestant Reformation, but remember the Anglican Reformation occurred at that point too, which was Venetian control. Henry VIII was totally controlled by Venice when he decided, well, I've got to have, you know, I'm going to form a church on the fact that I want to divorce this lady, right? I mean, that's not the basis to form a church. There might be other reasons to form a church, but that's not a good one, right? So that what you had was a proliferation of Aristotelian cults throughout Western civilization at that point. And it's interesting, and you shouldn't be shocked to know, that a man by the name of Paolo Sarpi, who was a Venetian Servite monk, was working with all the German princes to foster war, the 30 Years' War, to break up the Catholic Church, right? Now, there are bases on which you might change things, but to start a war, working with putative Catholics from Venice against the church would allow you to be a bit suspicious about what happened. Should make you a bit suspicious about what was up. Right? But this is Venice. They unleashed the 30 Years' War based upon religious disagreements. Calvin, directly Venice to Amsterdam. Right? And many of the bishops in the Catholic Church were totally, totally Venetian. So we've had a mess. The whole damn thing was manipulated. So that they could have power and manipulate, because the way the Venetians worked is they were Catholics, they were Protestants, they were Islamicists, they were everything. You cannot defeat the Venetians unless you start from a higher epistemological standpoint. If you do not start, you cannot tell. It's not the label that people give themselves. And that's the essence of the ghost seer. The essence of this Schiller thing is based upon the fact you cannot know anything by its labels. You have to know something by its content. Otherwise, you can be easily fooled, very easily fooled. But they can be defeated. And that's the point of our discussions. Because if you start with a clear conception of natural law, they go crazy about Lyndon LaRouche. They see in him the most fearful danger they have ever seen in their history. They go crazy about a person like that because he sees right through all the labels. And he doesn't look at the labels. He looks at the content. Right? And once you look at the content and judge the content, you know who's good and you know who's bad. And it doesn't really matter what their labels are, because it is an intelligible, knowable way of doing that. Leibniz was the same way. Leibniz was exactly the same way, and they hated Leibniz's guts. They were terrified of Leibniz, right? And they faced Kepler the same way. Bach, Mozart, the same way. Didn't matter what their religion was. What's the content? What's the content? What are we going at here? What do we have to understand? Right? What are we listening for? And that's the critical fight. The critical fight in Western civilization is, in fact, the knowledge of natural law. And the fight of Plato versus Aristotle. And the knowability of law versus the mysticism and Gnosticism of Aristotelian method. That's been the split in Western civilization. This came to a head in England, which is why most English colonies, including the United States, are totally insane on the issue of religion. Because of this. Now, how did this happen? Now, I happen to be somewhat of an expert on this. Not because I intended to, but I started out being a great fan of John Milton, who wrote Paradise Lost. I mean, I was a great fan. I used to teach classes and all sorts of things on this guy, right? But there was always something a little bit, I always wondered, it seemed very violent, the polemic in it, you know, and I'm not a violent person by nature, so I always wondered, maybe there's something wrong here. So through this, I began to study something called British Israel, the idea of British Israel, and where it came from. Because Milton was the great purveyor of British Israel. Okay? I mean, it came before, clearly, but it was but it took its height in the reign of Cromwell, Oliver Cromwell, who came to power in the 1630s, 1640s in England. From the 1640s to the 1660s is when Oliver Cromwell came to power in England. And there was a proliferation of the wildest cults you could imagine. And they took over England. These religious cults took over England. It's a long story, and if you're interested, I'll go into it in the question and answer period, but that's what happened. You had Socinians, Millenarians, Quakers, I mean, you name it, everything came in. Anglicans, Catholics, I mean, the whole place was ripped to ribbons, right? And there's a long story behind that, but that's what happened, right? There's a long story of religious war. England was ripped from religious war from the time of Henry VIII. I mean, you know, Henry VIII founds the Anglican Church. Then there's a war with the Anglicans and Presbyterians. Then there's a war, and they kill Mary, Queen of Scots, behead her, right? Then you have, from Mary, Queen of Scots, you have a number of this Cromwell people come in. And then there was about 20 to 30 religions at the time of the Cromwell's takeover of England. right? And it was based on populist dogma. A lot of it was populist dogma. And very powerful priests. Some were very good. Some were very bad. You have to know the difference, right? But the point was that what happened? What had happened was that the Venetian method had really even gotten out of hand, which it tends to do. It creates Frankenstein monsters. Because what you're introducing is pluralism into religion. In other words, since there is no organized doctrine of religion, then some will have insights, some won't have insights, you know, and you're introducing hundreds of cults and hundreds of differences of opinion, which you can manipulate, because that's Venetian method. You manipulate one cult against another cult. You can play one against another. That's old British divide and conquer, right? That's the way they do things. Divide on ethnic lines, divide on religious lines, find whatever divisions you can and begin to foster them, right? Now, the basis, though, the core of these beliefs, which you will find in Milton and you will find emphatically in British Israel, and you won't be surprised when I tell you, what do you think the core of the belief is? The doctrine of the elect, right? The idea that only certain priests, right, can know certain things. It's the doctrine of the elect, which is the basis for racial divisions and other things. Right? And by the way, you find this in Judaism, very emphatically. In Orthodox Judaism, only certain people can know things and other people cannot know things. These are the helots, right? The people who don't know anything are called helots or, you know, beasts, right? So you'll find the doctrine of the elect, and you will also find emphatically in Milton and emphatically in the more radical Calvinist and certainly the British Israel, the idea that the physical universe is purely evil, right? And read that in Paradise Lost, you will find what I'm saying there, right? Which is a long epic poem. Now, Paradise Lost was written as a refutation of Dante's Commedia, right? The famous called Divine Comedy by Dante, written in the 13th century, which is the basis for the Italian Renaissance. In which, yes, it is true, as Augustine knew, and certainly Luther and others referenced Augustine in this regard, that man is weak. There is no question about it. And therefore, he needs faith. But his faith informs his goodwill and his works. And that the universe itself is not purely evil. That is Gnosticism. That is the basis for Gnosticism. And anyone who preaches such a thing is a Gnostic, right? Because we've seen it through history. But the point is that to the extent that these cult doctrines became the basis of British Israel, racialism, and therefore racial divisions, and other things proliferated in the English empires, right? The doctrine of the elect, by the way, was always the basis upon which you would say blacks or Chinese or this one or that one were not God's children. That's how they argued it. That's how they argued it in the United States, the basis for slavery. When they argued it coherently, they argued it on the basis of it says so in the Bible, right? That they were elect and therefore others are not equal, right? Which, that's the way they argued it. And this was the basis of British Israel and John Milton. Now, what's interesting is that this stuff got fostered by the Venetians because it turns out that John Milton, in his early childhood, in his early years of being a poet, was toured by a man by the name of Henry Wooton. Henry Wooton was the ambassador of Britain to Venice. And they toured Milton in 1620 from England to Geneva to meet with the Venetian oligarchs in Geneva who had taken over Geneva, right, the Diodati, who were the guys who, after Calvin died, took over Geneva, the Diodati. And then from there, he was toured directly to Venice. and met with Paolo Sarpi, the putative Catholic, Venetian Franciscan, I mean Servite guy, to have discussions with all of the Venetians. So the putative great British Israelite Milton goes to meet with the Venetians in Geneva and goes down, and is toured by the Henry Wooten, and goes down to meet with the so-called Catholics in Venice to organize a continental conspiracy, right? And that continental conspiracy was the basis of the 30 Years' War. That's what happened. So how did this come to the English-speaking colonies? Well, they had this restoration in which this is the Hanover House came in, right? The House of Hanover, the glorious revolution. And they kicked out all these other religions, right? Or they were told these other religions to go to the English colonies to practice their religion, right? Now, I'm not saying it's all a conspiracy. What I'm saying is, to the extent that the basis of these other cults were proliferating in the English colonies, then what happens is that populism was almost a very natural offshoot of these kinds of cults, because it was not based upon the intelligibility of truth. Because if you're going to say, well, gee, you know, I feel good after this, well, that might be good or bad, you don't know, right? But since you have not been educated to the basis of natural law to understand what is intelligible in terms of the physical universe and the physical universe that God created, then you are left to opinion. That's all you are left. And on the basis of these kinds of things, what happens is that you have a highly uneducated population in terms of fundamentals. And the populist demagogues are always appealing to the idea that the only thing you know is that which you can perceive, always. They never go against your prejudice. And in fact, since the media and the way that this whole thing is manipulated is based upon prejudice and the creation of prejudice, unless you are willing to challenge people's prejudice, you are a populist. You're feeding into the thing, whether you like it or not. If you attempt to develop your polemics on the basis of what is acceptable to people, then you're not doing anything, because they've been trained in the exact opposite way, that there is only opinion. And therefore, the basis of our organizing is the exact opposite of populism. And the way that you defeat populism is by the fact that populism doesn't work. The law, it contradicts the laws of the physical universe. And because it contradicts the laws of the physical universe, what happens is at points of crisis, people realize it didn't work, and they look for alternative, actual solutions. Now, if at a point of crisis, you play a game with them, and you give them something acceptable, as opposed to, look, I'm going to challenge you in a way that you haven't been challenged before, because I love you and I want to save you. Right? If you don't have that idea about organizing, don't get into it. Because at the point of crisis, they're going to look for different solutions and different answers, because they've seen all the other answers. They've seen the populist rhetoric, and they felt good on Sundays, right? And they, you know, Reverend Bevel calls it religious entertainment, you know? I mean, these guys are great. Some of them are very funny. Some of them are, you know, quite witty. And they have partial insights, you know? But ultimately, at the point of crisis, everybody says, my God, you know, I've been wasting a lot of my time, right? And let me get serious here, right? And you're going to, so therefore the key, which is why you're going through these classes, and they're hard, because they contradict all your prejudices. You have a prejudice about most things, right? You have an idea that there's hard facts. I can prove to you there's no such a thing as a fact. I'll take any fact you give me and I'll tear it to ribbons and I'll prove to you it doesn't exist. Okay? I'll prove to you it doesn't exist, not in that way. It might have happened, but it doesn't exist in that way. That's not what caused it. Facts don't cause facts. Therefore, if you don't know what caused it, you don't know what it is. You don't even know it exists. You don't even know a fact exists if you don't know what caused it. You say, I see it. Well, what happens if I blind you? You don't see it anymore, do you? And I can do that ad infinitum. Right? So the question is, what is causal? What caused? And how is that causality coherent? And what are the laws of the universe? And on the basis of that, you can found a republic. And you can found a republic on the basis of nobility of the individual soul, on its noble qualities. Because what you do is, if you reduce men and women to opinion, to mere opinion, then you reduce them to hedonism. Because the only thing that they're left with is their feelings. And you've reduced them to hedonism, to a very small, narrow person. And because you've only given them their feelings, because you haven't given them, you know, they have no sense of their own dignity, they have no sense of their own worth, and they say, well, how am I any different than an animal, ultimately? And that's the problem with these cults, because, and that's the purpose of these cults. Right? Because, you see, if you know the truth, and you're surrounded by contrary opinion, but yet you know the truth, and you fight for the truth, then your soul and what you've done for humanity will continue long after you're gone. Right? Because you're not based your sense of identity on other people. Right? You're based upon, your sense of identity is based upon what is true from with respect to God's law. And if you know that about your life has been worth living. Because you've taught others by example or other ways. And therefore you've solved the fundamental question, what are we doing here? You're not determined by other people's opinion. You're here as human beings for a very specific purpose, to become ever less imperfect. You will never become perfect, you will never become God, but you'll become ever less imperfect. That is why you're here. That is why God created humans and not animals. I mean, he created animals, but he created humans for a very specific purpose. And that our forms of government must rest upon that fundamental difference between man and the animal. And not reduce men to animals and opinion and mere sense certainty. That is the basis of government. That is the basis of law. And the populist, Venetian in particular, in the way it's come through Western civilization, have reduced man to a lower level. We, on the other hand, are directly going against that to change the course of history. We can do that. But you've got to master this. There is, frankly, there is no other way. There's no tricks. There's no gimmicks. There's no way I can give you a quick, if you say this, then that'll happen. That's not the way it's going to work. Now, it's interesting because I want to discuss, finally, the question of, which is posed by Lincoln's Gettysburg Address. And I have it here, and it just happens to be in the last EIR. But I want you to think about it from what we've just discussed. Let me just read it to you again, because the words should resound. 67 years ago, our fathers brought forth upon this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived, so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here, have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note, nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather, to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead, we take increased devotion to that cause which they gave their last full measure of devotion, that we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain, and that this nation, under God, shall have a new birth in freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people, shall not perish from this earth. And that is the basis of a republic. That the only alternative would be to turn ourselves back to the oligarchs. And we've seen what a mess they've made of the world. Because all they care about is their own power and the increase of their own power through usury and any other basis they can. The alternative government is based upon the Christian idea of the nobility of the soul and the individual, and increasing the power to become ever less imperfect through education, through science, and through art, that we come closer to knowledge of the true nature of the universe that God created. And that is what a republic is about. So that's what I have.